right, good morning.
Good morning.
That was pretty good. I'll let it go with that. Stand with me. We're going to open up with a word of prayer, and we are going to get right into things this morning. We got a lot to do today. There's a lot going on here. We got some singing, and I may preach for about 3 hours a day. So, nah, I'll be wore out by then. I've only got one bottle of water, so that's as long as I can go. All right, but pray with me this morning. Father, we come today and we just thank you for this time that you've given us to come to your house and to worship together. We're going to ask that you be with our service today, Father. Be with all of our music today, Father. Be with all that will take part in this service today. And just help us all to participate. Help us all to get in and worship you today, Father. And just be with me later, Father, as I bring the word. Just help me to be aware of and aware of the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit wants said and what's done. And just be with each and every one of us and just help us to respond, Father, in a way that you want us to respond. Be with those that are sick, Father, those that aren't here because they're sick today, Father, those that are within our families that are struggling with these different physical problems, and we're going to ask you to touch them today. We're going to ask you to give them a physical healing today, Father, and we're just going to ask you to remove any distraction, any hindrance, anything that would stand in the way of the Holy Spirit moving in this place today. We give ourselves to you today, Father. We give this service to you today, Father, and we just ask you to have your way, and we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. All right. All right. Turn in your hymnals, or you can watch up on the board. We're going to be on page 84 and 85. We're going to sing "Grace Greater Than Our Sin," and then we're going to jump right over into "Amazing Grace." So that's pages 84 and 85. If you want to use a hymnal, all right. And Mason's going to try to have it up there on the screen for us. So sing with us now.
Will you with moment receive his God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sins. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Praise God, 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 praise God.
Now turn over to page 580. 580. His grace is sufficient for me. I'm going to sing about grace this morning.
Many times I'm tired and tested. As I travel day by day, oft I meet with pain and sorrow, and there's trouble in the way. But I have the sweet assurance that my soul the Lord will lead, and in Him there is strength for every need. Oh, His grace for me, even me, and His love is abundant and free. Oh, what joy fills my soul, just to know that His grace is sufficient for me. When the Templar brings confusion and I don't know what to do, on my knees I turn to Jesus, for I know He'll see me through. Then despair is turned to victory, every doubt just melts away, and in Him there is hope for every day. Abundant and free. Oh, what joy fills my soul, just to know that His grace is sufficient for me.
Amen. Amen. Y'all have a seat if you'd like. We're going to go ahead and take up our offering this morning, so if I can get some ushers to come up and help us out, we would greatly, greatly appreciate that. All right, Brother Eddie, you care to bless our offering for us this morning?
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling by the world has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. Cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange for a crown. In that old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. Will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. It's shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it it someday for a crown. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Yes, thank you, Lord. From your burden of sin, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or ill a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. Everybody, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. In the precious blood of the Lamb.
We got some birthdays this morning, honey.
Check one. Okay. Yeah, we do. We got two birthdays this morning. We should have a great big cake. Put them both together.
Oh, yeah.
Happy birthday to Ronald Lee and Brother D.
And Brother D. Boy, I tell you, that's good.
Y'all help us sing them happy birthday.
Help us sing.
Oh, happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Every day of the year, may you feel Jesus near. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, and the best years you've ever had.
pray for us as we sing up here. You know, as we see the things that's going on in today's society, you know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that it's going to be any day now that our Lord and Savior is going to be coming back. And so I just pray that that if you don't know him, that you'll get to know him before it's everlasting too late. You know, I'd be scared to leave this building here today and walk outside and not know the Lord. So hope you enjoy the words of this song. It's called Just Any Day Now. Each time I stop and take the time to look around me, I see the signs of his appearing everywhere. Things he said to come to pass are now before me. I can feel the strange excitement in the air. Just any day now, our Lord is coming. He'll be returning for you and me. Oh, I've been watching and I've been waiting just any day now. His face I'll see.
I'll see.
Amen. You know, and then when our Lord and Savior comes back just any day now, what a day that is going to be. So, this next song is called What a Day. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day, glorious day that will be.
All right, amen. That's a good. good singing this morning. Oh, y'all are good to go. All right, I tell you what, of our kids, 12 and under, if y'all want to go to children's church, you can go back with Sister Brooke. The rest of you, turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. Imagine that. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4 this morning. We've been there for, about 3 weeks now, but I got good news. We're going to run out of Scripture today. We're going to finish the chapter out. But Ephesians chapter 4, we're going to read verses 25 through 32 here in just a minute. And while you're finding that, just kind of just where we're at here, we're kind of right in the middle of our series. We've talked about being renewed quite a bit, and we've even began talking about being equipped last Sunday morning and Sunday night. We talked about being equipped, and then we're going to kind of finish that out today, and we're going to kind of move a little bit into the connecting part of this. This last portion here that Paul talks about, it's kind of a transitional section here, and it deals with the equipping to a degree, but it also transitions us over to that connecting part too. So it fits right in there. So like I said, we're going to be all over Ephesians 4 this morning, but we're going to focus on 25 through 32. So if you found that in your Bible, say amen. All right, now stand with me if you can. We're going to read that. Again, I'll be reading out of the NIV this morning. It says in verse 25, "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body." He says, "In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold." It says, "He who has been stealing must steal no more." And I've skipped a page. "Must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs." I'm going to read that again. "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, which whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." He says, "Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice." He says, "Be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgive each other just as in Christ God forgave you." Father, I come once again and just thank you for this time that you've given us. I thank you for our singing today. I just thank you for the obedience that we've seen today of the Holy Spirit. I'm just going to ask that you help us to continue to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. Help us to continue to heed the call, Father. Help us to continue to do all the things that you've called us to do. Help us to be aware of you speaking to us today, and just help us to respond to that. We're going to thank you, and we're just going to praise you today and give you all glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, all right. Thank you all. And so we're kind of following along Paul's thought process here quite a bit. And here in Ephesians chapter 4, he's really moving the church and progressing the church from one aspect of it to another. But they all kind of fit together there, and it's all kind of on a continuum there. And just to kind of recap where we've been here, remember one of the first things we talked about a few weeks ago was living our lives worthy of that calling. I love that. I'm going to have to write that down somewhere. That's become one of my favorite sayings there. It's just living our lives worthy of the calling which we have received. Worthy of that calling of God. And then we kind of looked into that, and we looked at what that looked like, and then we kind of moved in a little bit further and started looking at all the roles and responsibilities that we take on within the church that is kind of the outward sign, I guess, of that calling, of that living our lives worthy of that. And then last week we began to look at some things that Paul was telling us to do and to not do in that whole aspect. And one of the things he told us that we didn't want to do or what we needed to be doing is we need to be living our life differently than everybody else. Y'all remember that? We need to be living our lives differently and in a different manner. Things that are important to the world shouldn't really be that important to us and all those aspects. And one of the things that he says there in verse 18 of that chapter, he's talking about the Gentiles, the pagans, and the unbelievers. He talks about their way of thinking being futile, and he says that they are darkened in their understanding and separated separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. And he goes on in 19, it says, they have lost all sensitivity. They have given themselves over to sensuality and so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more and more and more. And it just never ends, and they're never satisfied, and they're never really in tune with God. And we see that going on in our world today. And we even talked about how we see that sometimes going on in the church as well. You know, we see all the things, all the crazy stuff that's going on in the church today. And this is the reason why, is because the church, and a lot of times, has adopted the same thinking and the same morality and the same way of doing things as the rest of the world. And Paul says, no, we're not to do that. We're to be just a little bit different. He says that us, he's talking about in verse 20, he says, you, however, did not come to know Christ that way. He says, surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. He says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life. He says, to put off your old self. Put off that old self. Be different than what you used to be. You're supposed to be changed and different and transformed. He says, put off your old self. He says, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. And he says, and be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, to be created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. And that sums up really the whole aspect of this. It's putting on the new self that's created to be like God in true righteousness and in holiness. And that's what Paul is calling all believers to do. You remember his message here is to the church, and he's given this message. He's saying God has called you to be different. God has made you to be different. When you're created new, when you've received Christ, he says you're not to be like everybody else. You're to be completely different. You're to be separate from the ways of the world. He goes on in 2 Corinthians. He tells if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. And Christ has made us new when we accept him. We're brand new in God's eyes. Well, all this old junk is gone. You know, and in Romans 12, 2, he talks about us being transformed by the renewing of our mind and all that. And so we do that. And when we become Christians, when we accept Christ, we're to be transformed. We're to be made new. But something happens after that. Something takes place after that. One or two things. Either we continue to grow and we continue to develop and continue to mature, or we become complacent. We become lazy. We get kind of satisfied where we're at. We think, oh, that's good enough. We get stagnant. We kind of get stuck. We get bored. Has anybody ever been bored in church before? I'm not going to ask if you're bored today. I got enough sense not to ask that. But have you ever asked yourself, why am I bored? Why am I bored? You know, maybe the preacher's boring. Well, sometimes. Maybe the music's boring to you. Well, sometimes. But just maybe, you're bored because you're not invested. Maybe it's you. Maybe you need to be renewed today. Maybe you're in need of some type of renewal. Because we have this whole thing we call church, and if you're not invested in it, it's going to be boring to you. We have to be invested in church. We have to remember, this isn't entertainment. This isn't designed to be entertainment. This isn't designed to be a show. This isn't the movies. This isn't a concert. We're here for specific reasons. We're here to worship God. We're here to become equipped, and we're here to equip others to carry out the work of the ministry. So if we're truly bored, then we need to examine ourselves and determine what it is. Because we're not going to have a song and dance here. Why are we bored? Are we invested? I'm going to give you a little example that I thought about for myself. I love playing baseball. Love it. Not getting good at it, but I love to play. Love it. But I cannot stand to watch baseball on TV. I am bored to death. If I start to watch a baseball game, I may get through the first inning, then I'm... And the reason I get bored with it is because I'm not invested in that game at all. And years ago, this will kind of show my age. Y'all remember when all the baseball players went on strike? It's like in the 80s, 90s, somewhere around in there. I don't know. It was a long time ago when they went on strike. After that, I kind of got disgusted with it. I used to love baseball. I used to love watching it. Johnny Bench, Cincinnati Reds. Woo, yeah, I was in it. I even had a little Johnny Bench bat and ball glove. And a baseball, too, I think, had his signature on there. I loved it. But after that, I was like, I'm done with it. So I wasn't invested in it. Now, you know, it's okay. It's, you know, if there's a game that goes into like extra innings or like in the World Series or something, I may watch the last few innings of it, but really I'm not invested in it. So it's not exciting to me. I could care less who wins. And when we have that attitude about church, when we can just care less about who wins, or we're not invested in it at all, we're just here, Joe, well, just because, then that's not a problem with the preacher, or not a problem with the singing, not a problem with the service, not a problem because it's warm or it's too hot or too cold, or we don't have enough programs, we got too many programs, we got this, we don't have that. It's because we're not invested in it, because we are not doing our part. And that's what we need to look at this morning. So, are you invested in it this morning? Are you going to get anything out of it? Because you have to be invested to do that. You have to be first, you have to be made new. Then you have to be renewed. And guess what? We all have to be renewed. It's not just a one time get renewed and woohoo, it's all good forever. We have to continually be renewed day after day after day after day. And when we don't do that, then we become bored and stagnated and just complacent and just We have to continually be renewed. And when we do that, Paul, verse 14 says, then we will no longer be like infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching. Our doctrine is what the King James says. And by the cunning and craftiness of men and their deceitful schemes. We won't be deceived by all this junk. But instead, he says in verse 15, we will speak the truth in love. We will in all things grow up into Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him the whole body joined and held together by every supporting ligament grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. We can grow up is what he's saying. He's telling us grow up, and he's saying you can be grown up. You can submit to the equipping of the Holy Spirit, how the Holy Spirit can equip you and prepare you. For what? What is He going to prepare us for? Well, back up to verse 12. He says to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. We are equipped so we can equip somebody else, so we can prepare other people, so we can build up the body of Christ, so the church can be strong. So the church can be strong. So the church is not fragmented over here and over there, but the church is united. Because the church cannot be strong if the people in the church are not strong. The church cannot be built up unless the people are built up. The church can't be equipped unless the people are equipped. And it's up to us to decide whether or not we want to do that, whether or not we want that. For our church, for our community, for our families, for our friends, for ourselves. We have to decide, is that what we want? Is this really what we want? And if it is, then we get invested in the process. We get involved in it. So, now I'm going to preach about what we came to hear today. That was a review. Verse 25, he's going to tell us how this whole process kind of connects together, how this equipping and connecting, how it kind of intertwines together because they go together. Because you cannot equip someone else unless you're connected with them. And he's going to tell us some behaviors that we need to be aware of and some things that we need to take into consideration and keep in mind when we're trying to connect. He says in verse 25, he says, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. Now, why would Paul be talking to a bunch of church people about lying, about not being truthful? Raise your hand if you've ever been lied to. Yeah, everybody. Now, don't raise your hand, but think about it. Have you ever been lied to by somebody that claims to be a Christian? That says yes. And we all know, well, we're not supposed to judge people, but what's it make you think about them in their faith? In their relationship with God? If you can't trust them with the small things, how are you going to trust them with the big things? Would you want to connect with somebody like that? I wouldn't. So Paul says, don't do it. Don't be that way. He's talking about our integrity, our character, being honest, being above reproach. But what about us? Have we ever told a lie? If we say no, we're probably lying. Well, what about now? What about now? Do we ever tell lies? Those little white lies, oh, they won't hurt anybody. But watch it. A lie is a lie. Or what about those things that aren't out-and-out lies, but you kind of make things sound just a little bit different. You kind of change things just a little bit different. Not you're not out-and-out telling somebody a lie. Technically, what you're saying is true, but your intent is to deceive somebody. Is to have them think something differently. We ever see that happening? It's a lie, just the same. It may technically be the truth, but it's a lie. Because your intent is not to be truthful with them, because you want them to believe something that's not exactly the way it is. What about promising somebody that you're going to do something, or you're going to help them with something, or you're going to be here, or you're going to be there, and you don't show up? Now, sometimes things happen. But what do you do to make that right? Do you call and say, hey, I ain't going to make it. This came up. And I'm not talking about, whoa, I'd rather do this over here. So I'm just going to... I'm talking about legitimate things. Because things come up. That's life. But do we have a habit of making promises and not keeping them? It's a lie when we do that. When we don't make it right. We don't try to rectify and correct the situation. It's still a lie. Think about it. That happens in the church. It happens. You know who we lie to the most? God. How many promises have we ever made to God? Are we keeping those promises? Have we broke some of those promises? How are we doing with that today? How honest are we with God? Think about it. Because Paul, again, he's talking about being honest. And we have to be honest with God, and we've got to be honest with ourselves. You know, part of being honest, we are honest with others, honest with God, and honest with ourselves. So be honest with yourself. Examine yourself today. Where are you at here? Where do you stand here? After honesty, he begins to talk about our emotions a bit. He says in verse 26, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. Now you'll notice he didn't say, don't get mad, don't get angry. He didn't say that. Paul recognizes, Paul understands that anger is a normal human emotion. There are times when you should be angry. But in your anger, he says, do not sin. There's a difference. You can be angry, but don't sin. There is that thing called self-control. You remember the fruit of the Spirit? Self-control. Learn to control yourself. And don't sin. When you get angry, fine. You're angry. Deal with it in a godly way. We've all seen people that they'll get mad and they'll just blow up all over the place. They may give you a cussing or whatever, I don't know. But do you want to connect with people like that? No, you don't want to be around somebody like that. So Paul says, watch yourself. He says, use some self-control. He says, when you're angry, that's fine, but don't sin. Don't sin in it. And then he says, do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Now, what he's talking about there is when you're angry at somebody, deal with it. Do what you need to do to make it right, to make it okay. He says, don't dwell on those things. Don't let that stuff kind of fester. Because the only thing it does is give Satan a foothold. It is something that drives a wedge between people, that divides people. You remember what John says? It's 1 John. He says, if anybody says they love God but they hate their brother, they're a liar. So think about it. Deal with it. Because when you let it kind of fester up, then it goes from there and it just gets worse. I'm going to show you something in James. You are familiar with these. James chapter 1, verse 13. It says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. I mean, this is what I wanted to get to. But each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Now, what's that got to do with being angry and sin? Well, basically what happens is it starts out, you're angry and you're letting that fester up. Then it turns into a desire to get even, to get back, to hurt them the way they hurt you. That temptation turns to desire. And when that desire gets to the point that you begin to act on it, when they come around, you say, I don't want to talk to you. Or they come up to you. When it moves to sin, then you're in trouble. Because now you have sin, and now you either need to make things right with God and them, or, what does it say? It gives birth to death. The wages of sin is death. And it's not a joke. Deal with it before it gets to that point. If you can't talk to that person, then you pray and pray and pray. Don't pray for them, but pray that God will soften your heart. That's the only way you're going to take care of it. So don't allow Satan that foothold to get control over you. Because what happens is people get mad. Somebody over here on this side of the church is mad at somebody on that side of the church. And it drives a wedge in the church. You wonder why the church is not effective? Because people in the church can't get along. And people can't get along because they're not filled with the Holy Spirit. Because they're not controlled by the fruit of the Spirit. They're controlled by their flesh. Give it up. Be under God's control for a minute. Let God be in charge for a little while. Let Him call the shots. And then we'll be okay. Then we won't have all the problems that we see going on in the church world. Because guess what? In God's kingdom, you don't have those issues. It's only in man's kingdom. So, he goes on. And he says, he who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with his own hands that he may have something to share with those in need. Now, why in the world are you talking about stealing? I mean, surely. He ain't gonna... Is that what he's talking about? Stealing from people? Surely not. To some extent, because that goes on. You've got people in the pews, in the pulpit that are stealing, robbing the people every day. Robbing them physically, financially, robbing them spiritually, robbing them emotionally. It's going on. He says, don't be a thief. But we're also robbing God, too. I talked a little bit last week about our time, our talents, and our treasures. You remember that? We're robbing God when we don't give Him our time. When we don't give God our talents. And when we don't give God our treasures. Oh, isn't it? Oh, that's Old Testament. It's still the Bible. And I don't pound people over the head. It don't matter to me. That's between you and God. If you're not doing what God's called you to do with your time, your talents, and your treasures, He'll deal with you. I ain't got to. I ain't got time to. I'm going to read you something out of Malachi chapter 3. Yes, in the Old Testament. It says in verse 6, I, the Lord, do not change. That means, and actually if you go over to Hebrews, he also says, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. But in Malachi, I, the Lord, do not change. So in other words, the same God that wrote the Old Testament is the same God that wrote the New Testament. The same God that was there with Abraham, Isaac, and Joseph is the same with Moses, is the same God that is with us today. He says, I, the Lord, do not change. So you, O descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Sound familiar? He says, return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. That's a good verse there for some backsliders. Return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord God Almighty. If you have wandered from God, you return to God and He will return to you. It's as simple as that. You don't have to overcomplicate it. You just come back to God and it's all good. You pray, you repent, you ask forgiveness, you get up and you walk with God. We overcomplicate things. But anyway, I got to move on. It says, return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? How are we to return? He says, will a man rob God? Will a man rob God? And we say, no. He says, yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? In tithes and offerings. In tithes and offerings. He says, you are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. The church is robbing God. Time, talents, and treasures, all three. The church has become more about business and more about itself than it has become about glorifying God. And about preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. He says, you are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, and there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much a blessing that you will not have room enough for it. Now, I'm not going to stand up here and tell you, you put a dollar in the offering plate, that God's going to give you $1,000. That's a lie. That's a lie, and that's part of the way that they're robbing God. So that they can buy houses and build buildings and buy airplanes and all this other garbage. But God will bless you for being obedient to God. It don't make a bit of difference whether you put a nickel or $100 in there. It don't matter. God has called you to be obedient in all things. And that's what matters, is whether you're obedient or not. Whether you're obedient to what God has called you to do and to be and to give. That's what matters, is the obedience factor. And that's up to you. That goes back to being honest with yourself and examining yourself. And Paul says this. He says, we must work doing something useful with our own hands that we may have something to share with those in need. Idleness, wasting time. In verse 29, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And he's not talking about just giving somebody a cussing here, about being unwholesome talk. He's talking about things like slander, like gossip, like being just negative in general. He's talking about things like running the pastor down. Running the pastor of another church down. Running another church down. He says it's unwholesome. And it's unwholesome because it is not used to build anybody up. He says if it needs to be helpful in building up others according to their needs. And if it doesn't benefit those who may listen, then it don't need to be said. We need to keep it to ourselves. Because it's useless, it's idle, it's careless. Matthew 12:36 says, but I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless, King James says, idle word that you have spoken. Remember that. We will give an account. We will stand before God. In verse 30 it says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Now, he's not talking about blaspheming the Holy Spirit either. That's different. We don't have time to go into that today. That's a whole different sermon series. He's talking about grieving the Holy Spirit. He's talking about doing the things that God has said don't do. He's talking about not doing the things that God has said to do. Causing grief on the Holy Spirit. That's what he's talking about. Being disobedient to God. He says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice, and we're to replace it with being kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ forgave you. We're to be sincere about our faith. So where are we at this morning? Y'all care to come? Just hang with me for just a few more minutes. Where are we at this morning? Maybe you're here and you've never been made new. You have never accepted Jesus Christ. You can do that today. You can take care of that today before you leave here today. Maybe you need to be renewed today. You can do that too. Maybe you've been robbing God in some way. You can make that right too. Bottom line is, whatever God is calling, whatever God is telling you, you have to be obedient to that. You have to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. Not to me or any song. Be obedient to God. So if God has called you to do anything, to say anything, to come and to pray, I would encourage you to get up out of your seat and do it. It's not that scary up here, trust me. It's not. So if y'all stand with me, if you don't care, they're going to sing. And I just want you all, just like I said, just be obedient to God.
God's children too long have been burdened. They are longing for heaven's green shore, where heartaches are left far behind us, and burdens are carried no more. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest 'neath the evergreen tree. So I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory. Sometimes I'm despised and rejected, and I question, oh Father, how long? Then I take one more look at Mount Calvary, and it gives me the strength to go on. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest 'neath the evergreen tree. So I'll carry my cross cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Come morning, I'll walk by the river. I'll rest neath the evergreen trees. So I'll carry my cross through the midnight. Come morning, there's glory for me. Come morning, there's glory for me.
Amen. Amen. Does anybody have anything to say or do before we dismiss? All right. Don't forget about tonight, 6 o'clock. Brother Dennis will be preaching for us. I'm all the way from King B. So pray for him. Come back and support him in that. So, all right. I won't hold us any longer. Pray with me. Father, we come once more and we just thank you for this time. We just ask you to bless and be with each family that's represented here today, Father. Just help them as they go home. Just help them to glorify you in all things today, Father. And just guide them. Keep them safe, Father, as they go about, and just help them in their daily walk, Father, to put you first. We just thank you today and we just praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.